It tore my heart to fear and grace my fears relief. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. That we've already come, 'tis grace that brought us safe so far, and grace will lead us home. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, oh, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. I was blind, but now I see.
So appropriate that we would begin the service with a Kenny Rogers song. I know Kim loved him. On behalf of Kim's family, I want to welcome you and thank you for showing your love for Kim and for her family by attending the service. I don't know that I've ever seen such a long line of people wanting to pay their respects. I also want to let you know that the Mulkey family have provided for a meal at 3 o'clock at Central Christian Church. It's on Villa Avenue up by Oakwood Nursing Home. And they have, there's enough for all of you. And they would love to have you join them for a meal at 3 o'clock, especially if some of you didn't have an opportunity to greet the family before the service. I know that they would be happy to speak with you there. There will also be a point in the service where a few of you, if you'd like to share a couple of words about Kim or memory or tribute, you will be welcome to do that. My name is Carl Ruby, and for the past 7 years, I have been Kim's pastor. And for 3 or 4 of those years, Kim was my administrative assistant. And she wasn't just an assistant, she was a very close friend to Susie and I and to my family. Kim was someone who I could confide in, someone who I could turn to for advice. And like many of you who are here today, I am deeply grieving her death. But we are here today not only to grieve, but to celebrate. And I want you to just imagine for a moment what this service would be like if Kim had planned it. We would all be in costumes, matching t-shirts made for the occasion. She would have picked some goofy theme. She and Carly would have visited 15 party stores to get napkins in just the right color. We would all end up playing bingo eventually, and some of us would even go home with prizes. Kim was a uniquely special person. Kim was a uniquely good person. And today, we want to honor her spirit of hope and joy and optimism as she would wish. And the focus of our service and my comments today won't be on her death, but on her life. Please join me in prayer. Father, we begin by thanking you for the gift of knowing Kim Mulkey. Of all the gifts you've given us, few are as precious as Kim. We thank you for her free spirit, for her generous heart, for her caring hands. We thank you for her courage and for her faith. Use these moments that we have together this afternoon to honor a life well lived. Help us to realize that the most beautiful things about Kim are glimpses of you and of your character. Help us to comprehend that her joy is a mere reflection of your joy. That her love for those who are gathered here today is but a fraction of your love. Allow our deep love for Kim to deepen our love for you. Father, we are so grateful for Christ, knowing that so many of the beautiful things about Kim were places where Jesus was working through her to bless others. Her love for those on the margins, her attention to those who are sometimes forgotten, remind us of the breadth of your love and the depth of your compassion. Father, we come to you today with hearts that are hurting and heavy, and we ask you in your time to bind them up. Walk with us through the valley of the shadow of death. Lead us to green pastures and still waters and restore our souls. We pray for those closest to Kim, asking that your goodness and mercy would follow them all the days of their lives and be especially present with them right now. We ask these things in the name of Jesus, our wonderful counselor, the Prince of Peace. Amen. Allow me to read Kim's obituary. I just want to comment for a moment on how well written and thoughtful it is. I get to read a lot of obituaries, but I felt that this one really captured Kim's spirit, and can tell that you put a lot of thought and care into it. She would be pleased with it. Kimberly Diane Mulkey Robe, 54, passed away on September 20th, 2021 at Springfield Regional Medical Center after a courageous battle with cancer. She was born January 26, 1967 in Springfield, Ohio. Kim graduated from Kenton Ridge High School in 1985, where she was an avid member of the band, playing almost every instrument. Kim loved spending time with her friends and family and had many memories of long bicycle rides and weekends camping. Kim worked for Emerald Marketing Speedway for 16 years, where she met her husband and love of her life, Sam, and created many lifelong friends. She left Speedway for her favorite job, which was to be the best mom. She was a member of Central Christian Church, where she worked as the office manager for several years, alongside some of her dearest friends. Kim put her faith into action. She was the kind of light that you only get from Jesus. She was kind and went out of her way to make everyone she came into contact with feel loved. Kim consistently put other needs ahead of her own and was always thinking of new ways to make someone's day. The extent of her generosity and kindness cannot be put into a few words. Many weekends were spent delivering Cheryl's cookies or Young's ice cream to make someone smile. She also loved get-togethers to make special memories with others, especially in their time of need. Kim showed her love to every animal. Over the years, she rescued many dogs, but also found joy in feeding vanilla Oreos to her backyard friends, squirrels, birds, and rabbits. Kim is survived by her parents, Ned and Judy Robe of Springfield, her husband of 26 years, Sam, children Samuel, Dean III, and Carly Brianna, brother Larry, Ray and Joanne Powell of Theodosia, Missouri, sister Tammy and Jim Kindleberger of Springfield, sisters-in-law Dawn Robe of Leonardtown, Maryland, and Cindy Johns Powell of Benson, Arizona, mother-in-law Judy Hall of Springfield, numerous aunts, uncles, cousins, nieces, and nephews, and countless friends that became family, and her best friend, Marlene Sisler. She was preceded in death by her brother Todd, her grandparents Bill and Eileen Beekman, grandparents Eugene and Marjorie Robe, special aunt and uncle Carl and Bernadine Anderson, father-in-law Norm Hall, special cousin Shelley Mulkey, for whom Kim became guardian, and numerous aunts, uncles, cousins, and nephews. The family wishes to thank Dr. Singh, Dr. Cutwall, Dr. McQuillan, Dr. Gabbard, and Dr. Ohlers, as well as each of their staff members for the intimate and wonderful care that they provided. An additional thank you is extended to the staff of Springfield Cancer Center, as each of you went beyond caregiving to become Kim's friends. For those who wish to give a gift in Kim's honor, she and her family ask that you consider the SASS Rescue Center in Urbana or the Breast Cancer Endowment Fund of Clark County. I spent time with Sam and Samuel and Carly and Ned and Judy collecting memories of Kim, and I would like to share just a few of them with you. I collected 12 pages of notes of beautiful things that Kim did and people who she served. And it was difficult picking through all of those stories to select a few that best capture her generous personality and spirit. Ned and Judy remember Kim as a quiet, easy baby who transitioned very naturally into a loving and nurturing child. There were 4 years between Kim and her younger brother, Todd, and at a young age, Kim took to mothering her younger brother. That's an early hint that Kim would be a person selflessly devoted to caring for other people. One time, Ned and Judy discovered that Kim had helped Todd build 17 snowmen who were all standing guard in their front yard. Kim's love for animals, or as Ned called them, critters, also started early with gerbils and hamsters. And one time, Kim went to the dime store and came home with what she thought was a baby hamster. Instead, she had purchased a mouse. Kim probably would have been content with a mouse, but Ned and Judy helped her exchange it for a real live hamster. Recently, Kim and Carly were driving around town and they came upon a turtle that had been hit by a car. And while most people would have just driven around it, Kim rushed out to buy a tub and a shovel so that she and Carly could rescue the turtle and take it to a nearby turtle rehab facility. A little clue into how caring she was. Her tenderness with animals led to a tenderness with people. Another early sign of the person who Kim would become was her care for her uncle Carlos, who had lost both of his legs. She took it upon herself to give him extra attention and to be his caretaker. And later, she would do the same for her grandmother Eileen and her aunt Bernadine. near the time that her Aunt Bernadine died, Kim threw her a pajama party. And Kim slept near her aunt's bed so that she could care for her. Her aunt had to get up frequently during the night, and on one occasion she looked over at Kim and said, "Isn't this fun?" And for Kim, it probably was. It's exactly the kind of thing she would want to be doing. Kim was great, but she wasn't perfect. When she was in high school, one morning she got up to find that her car was missing. And no, it wasn't stolen. She had forgotten a few payments, and it was repossessed. If she had disclosed that, I might not have hired her to be the church bookkeeper. When Kim graduated from high school, she went to work for Emro, which later became Speedway, and there she met the love of her life. Speedway only employed about 100 people in the main office at the time, and Sam worked during the night with credit card receipts, and he worked during the night, and Kim recorded them during the day. Kim and Sam worked together for a number of years, and Kim was always dating someone else. But one day, Kim was unattached, and someone suggested to Sam that he maybe ought to ask her out. Their first date was to be a day at the fire department ox roast, but Kim showed up the night before to help out Sam with a fundraiser. As soon as she got there, Sam was called out on a house fire. As Sam rushed out to put out the fire, he put Kim in charge of the fundraiser. She asked how much to charge people, and as Sam rushed off, he said, "Charge them whatever you want." He returned several hours later. The fundraiser was complete. The money had been counted and tallied, and everything had been put away. Part of their date the next day was an airplane ride. Sam said that Kim had never been up in a plane, and he figured that she might just be scared enough to reach out and grab him. She did, and she never let go. They dated for about a year and a half, and during the time that they were dating, Sam had purchased a house, and as he remodeled it, he would always ask Kim for advice, assuming that she would be living in it with him. He had elaborate plans for a fancy proposal, but Kim showed up early, befuddling his carefully made plans. Her ring was still in a plastic bag. But Sam mustered a proposal, and Kim eagerly accepted it. And that is just the way Kim would have wanted it. She would always fuss over others, but never wanted anyone to fuss over her. A couple of years after they were married, Sam and Kim took a vacation to Opryland, and 9 months later, Samuel arrived. 2 years later, he was joined by Carly. When Carly was born, Kim decided to focus all of her attention on being a mom. Sam said, "At first I didn't approve, but I'm glad she stuck her ground. Whenever times were rough, I could always count on Kim to make the right decision." When Carly was young, she needed an expensive formula called Neocate. One day, just before Kim arrived to pick her up, Ned set Carly out by the curb with a sign that said, "We'll work for Neocate." I understand that Ned also wrote to Congress Hobson asking him why Neocate had to be so expensive. If there were themes to Kim's life, there would be four. One was her love for Jesus. The second was her love for her family. The third was her love for having fun. And the fourth was her love for serving other people. I asked Sam and Samuel and Carly to share words that described Kim. Fun. A servant's heart. Focused on others. Weird and wacky. That led to a story about visiting 14 different stores to pick out a baby pig costume for a friend. She was creative. Every holiday or event had to have a theme. She was all in. Sam used a different term, saying that she never did anything and it rhymes with half asked. She never cut corners when caring for others. And I'm a beneficiary of this trait. In the closet, in a closet that's in my office at church, there is a huge inflatable bear that she would blow up every November for my birthday. And I'm going to leave it right there on the shelf as a reminder of Kim. Joyful and generous. Sincere. Sam said, out of every 1,000 people who say they will pray for you, maybe 3 or 4 really will. Kim would. Carly observed, Mom woke up every day determined to make someone's day better. Each morning she would tell Kim, Kim would tell Samuel and Carly, don't forget to do your good deeds. There's so much evidence of Kim's thoughtfulness, but one story that I wanted to share was that Kim always wore blue on Mondays. Mondays are the day that we count the offering at church. And a woman named Fern Williams, who's sitting just around the corner here, would come in and help count the money on Mondays. And one day, Fern mentioned that she loved blue. And from that day on, every Monday, Kim would wear blue from head to toe as a token of her appreciation to Fern. She did her brother Todd's favorite color was black, so on his birthday, she would always honor his memory by wearing black. She would honor the birthdays of her grandmother Eileen and Aunt Bernadine by getting their favorite pizza. Kim had a very casual style, but she expressed herself through clothing. For Judy's last radiation treatment, she had t-shirts made up for the entire family all around the theme of owls. One thing that I noticed as Kim's pastor is that as her cancer advanced, she nearly always wore t-shirts that were expressions of her faith. And you see many of them here to my right. But I don't think I ever saw her without a t-shirt that in some way bore evidence of her faith and her confidence and her love for people. I attempted to pastor Kim through her battle with cancer, but she made it difficult. Not once did she come to me discouraged or asking why. The more she suffered, the more she served. Wherever Kim went, she accumulated new friends. She even made friends in checkout lines. At the grocery store, she would insist on standing in a certain line, even if it was the longest one, just so that she could say hi to a salesperson she had met on an earlier trip. One day when Samuel was about 7 years old, she took him to a craft store and he bumped into a stack of frames, causing them to tip over and break. Kim made Samuel find the salesperson so that he could apologize and take responsibility for his mistake. Kim discovered that the salesperson had a wife who was ill, so she befriended him, going back to the store to take him lunch over and over and over again. One day even setting off fireworks in his yard. This gentleman had several barns that were filled with junk and things he'd collected, and Kim took it upon herself to clean all of them out and to arrange a barn sale, and she and the gentleman remained friends until he died. And there's so many stories just like that. One day Sam came home to find a strange man in the shower. It was a man who Kim knew from Speedway who had fallen upon hard times and become homeless. She had sought him out and found him, and together she and Sam and her family helped him get back on his feet. Now he is an STA in a nursing home. Stories like this are too many to tell. But being a blessing to others was an obsession for Kim. She would find people who were alone and take her family over for pizza and to play Rummy 13. Not just once or twice, not just a token act of kindness, but something that they would do over and over and over again because for some people do things that are kind because we know that we ought to do things that are kind. But Kim did them because that's just who she was. That just flowed directly from her heart, and it's what she wanted to do. On Memorial Day, Kim developed a tradition of putting out blue bags, individually decorated, to honor a person's life who had passed, with candles. They put candles in them and put them on their driveway. Each year, the list of bags would grow longer. Just this last Memorial Day, as she was lying in the hospital, she learned that a nurse had lost her husband. She called Sam, insisting that he go out and get enough supplies to do one more bag in honor of the nurse's husband. This past Valentine's Day, Sam wanted to do something special for Kim. He asked what she wanted to do, and Kim said, "I want to deliver gifts." And together, they delivered Valentine gifts to 48 different people. I want to pause here for just a moment to compliment Sam. Sam would often be drawn into Kim's elaborate schemes. And not all husbands would be as patient and supportive as Sam was. But this was something the whole family embraced. And it became, it's part of the family identity. And I just want to compliment each of you for the way that you supported Kim and allowed her to be the person that she was. And in many ways, you reorganized your lives around her generosity. And you are to be commended for that. Even parent-teacher conferences were an opportunity for Kim to love on people. She felt sorry for teachers who sat alone waiting for parents who often didn't show up. So she would go to parent-teachers conferences and walk around and sit with teachers who were sitting by themselves, just so that they didn't have to sit there waiting for someone to show up. And she did that over and over and over again. Kim's thoughtfulness has been a blessing at Central Christian Church. Valentine's Day, Veterans Day, Grandparents' Day, she was always finding a way to let people know that they mattered and that they were valued. Kim had many special friends at church, but there are a couple who stand out to me. One was Kevin Smith and the other was Matt Cunningham. Each of you meant so much to Kim. She prayed for you, and she loved you. And just as she gave you great joy, you gave joy to her. And the list of friends is far too long, but those are a couple that Kim paid special attention to. In December of 2018 or January of 2019, Kim discovered that she had cancer. Susie and I were eating out when she called me with the news. And if anything, her generosity and focus on others just increased. When others might have become obsessed with their own well-being, Kim's care for others took on a new sense of urgency. I think two things account for Kim's unusual kindness and generosity. First of all, I think it was just her nature. It wasn't something that she did. It was who she was. And second, it was the Spirit of Jesus shining through Kim's actions. After their children were born, Kim and Sam had a renewed commitment to Christ. They were baptized and got involved in a local church. Eventually, God led them to Central, and boy, am I glad that he did. We are a better church because of it. Kim has left a deep mark on our lives and a deep mark on our church, a mark that looks like Jesus. Jesus taught us to go the extra mile, to turn the other cheek, to treat others as we would like to be treated, and Kim made that her life. And she would want us to make that our lives as well. I have a few other comments. But I want to provide a time, if there's anyone here who would like to share a memory or a thought or a tribute, you are welcome to do that. Is there anyone who would like to share a memory or a thought about how Kim has been a blessing to you? And I think, Rob, you have a microphone. Just slip your hand up if you'd like to say something, and Rob will get that to you. Annie, you just speak up. Annie works at our church and works very closely with Kim.
She just, I've only known her for 4 years, but she's just my very dear, dear friend. As you were speaking about her,
can't hear in the other room.
How she felt about all the animals. I'd probably only been working at the church 2 weeks, and Kim caught me getting ready to kill a spider. Lo and behold, she yelled at me.
Grab the mic there so everyone can hear you.
Oh, okay. So I'd only been at the church cleaning for about 2 weeks, and Kim caught me killing a spider. And she reamed me. She made me pick the spider up into a tissue, take it outside, and let it go. And I'll never forget, she looked at me and she said, "They're God's creation too, Annie." And there's many more, but that one just really stuck with me.
Yep.
Thanks for sharing.
There's a hand way in the back.
Okay, hi. Kim collected people like some of us collect things. During her illness, she took time to deliver packages to our son Todd in a nursing home, and that's what I'll always remember about her.
Anyone else have a thought that they would like to share? And I know that many of you may be uncomfortable sharing a story like that in a context like this, but if you come to the meal at 3, I know that the family would love to hear some of those stories and tributes. I want to close by reminding you that each of us bear the image of God. It is our job to reflect God and His love to others. And in each of us, that reflection is distorted. We distort it when we do things that we shouldn't or fail to do things that we should. But when we turn to Jesus, He begins a process of repairing it. And we saw that process at work in Kim, who became more like Jesus with each passing year. There's a passage in the book of Hebrews that reads, "No discipline or trial seems pleasant at the time, but painful. Later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who are trained by it." Watching Kim battle cancer was watching a harvest of peace and righteousness. From day one, Kim was at peace with her diagnosis. Any regrets that she may have had were for her family and for her friends, not for herself. We can't help but grieve, but Kim would want us to grieve with hope. We honor Kim by taking her most beautiful qualities and making them larger parts of who we are. In the days ahead, she would say to us what she often said to Samuel and Carly, "Make sure to do your good deed today." And she would encourage us to turn our eyes upon Jesus. "O soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see? There's light for a look at the Savior, and life more abundant and free. turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Let me close with prayer. Father, we come to you hurting people. We come to you with very heavy hearts. Father, we come to you with deep, deep concern for Sam and Carly and Samuel and Ned and Judy. And we entrust them to your loving care. Father, we come incredibly thankful for Kim. Lord, knowing her is one of the richest blessings of many of our lives, and we thank you for that. Father, we thank you for the hope of life eternal and for the evidence of Kim's strong and enduring faith. Lord, faith strong enough to face a battle with cancer. Father, I pray for the many people who have been touched by Kim's kindness, and I pray that you would raise up others to follow her example of loving the people around us. Father, I pray you'd help us to become more like Kim. Lord, help us to honor her memory by becoming like her, and in becoming like her, becoming more like Christ. Father, I pray especially for Kim's immediate family, and I pray that your grace would sustain them. I pray that you would help them. Lord, this is something they will never get over, but I pray that you will help them to get through this. And I pray that you would reward them with a million beautiful memories of an amazing mom, a wife, and daughter. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Folks, on behalf of the Mulkey family, they're extremely grateful for your patience to be here to show your love and support. On a personal note, I did know them as friends, and I stand before a family who expresses servanthood as a family, not just one person in the family, the entire family does, and just so grateful for you and your community and your sense of community. So we love and support you, this entire place does, and everybody here. With that, I know Carl's mentioned twice, but we want to make sure you do have the opportunity, the family's made the opportunity that you can go to the Central Christian Church to have a time of food and fellowship following our time at Rose Hill. I'm going to ask that if you are going to the cemetery, even as you're dismissing, that you would just kind of stand and directly go to your cars to prepare to go to the cemetery. If you're going to go, please put your hazards on. I know there's a lot of cars everywhere, all over our lot and elsewhere, so put your hazards on and we'll make sure that you're safely marked with a flag. If you're going to serve the family as a pallbearer, I'm going to ask that you would let us know in the hallway and we're going to put a boutonniere on your shirt or lapel. I'd also like the opportunity for the family and immediate family to be in the room alone with Kim. So I thank you for your swift exit and we'll continue on with our service and the meal. Thank you.
When this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore.